So I'll give you a quick introduction on Kalai. Okay, now she has been an accredited practicing dietitian for the last 10 years. And she's going to talk about today about blood pressure and management of blood pressure. So what is a good thing? What is blood pressure? We'll understand what is blood pressure, how we can manage it if you have high blood pressure or low blood pressure, how your diet also affects your blood pressure. This and many other topics we will talk about today this evening. And if you have any doubts or question, feel free to put them up into the chat box, or you can even ask us at the end of the program. Okay. So I think we have enough of people. We can just start the session right now. Hi, good evening. Good evening, Kalai. So
hi.
Like I told you, we are the Khayal Clubhouse members. You know, we meet every Saturday and we have discussions on elder issues. And we are glad to have you here today to talk to us about blood pressure. So just a quick question, you know, we wanted to know you a little bit more before we start the session. You know, so my name is Vikas. All of us, you know, we can give you our name, but that'll take forever. But I'm going to be the host this evening, and we just want to know a couple of things about you. So okay. Would you like to share a couple of details for us before we start the session?
All right. So my name is Kalain Dumedius. I know it's a little bit of a tongue twister, but that's okay as long as you remember me as Kalain. I have been a dietitian for more than 10 years now. I did do my master's in clinical dietetics. I studied for a few years in Australia. Then I've come back. I've been working in multiple setups. So I've worked at hospitals, at clinics, at gyms. Over the last 10 years, in fact, I have been working very closely with weight management patients, so with patients with obesity and obesity-related problems. So the last 10 years of my life have been primarily with weight loss and obesity. And obviously, now I'm also sort of doing private consultations and talks and webinars, because my passion is basically to educate, because I feel that there's so much of information, especially over the last few years on the internet, WhatsApp forwards and all of that. And I feel like it is my sole duty to be able to put right all of the misinformation that's out there as much as I can do. So that's my passion. And so when Khayal sort of approached me to talk to all of you guys, I could not sort of let go of the opportunity to do that. And I thought blood pressure and management of blood pressure was something that most of us are struggling with and have questions with. So I thought it would be a good topic to discuss. About me. I'm from Bombay, have been born and brought up in Bombay, except for the few years that I was out studying. So lovely to meet all of you.
That's great. That's great to know a little bit about you. I also want to add a couple of things so that our members know a little bit more about you. So you are also a founder of Nutritionally Yours, right?
Yes. Yes.
You can tell us a little bit about that also later on in the program. And you have also been working with a lot of Bollywood celebrities. I wouldn't mind some gossip if you got to share it, okay?
So Nutritionally Yours is my baby. So that's the company I founded. I'm very passionate about that. And that is what part of my education sessions is part of what I do at Nutritionally Yours. My Bollywood celebrities were part of when I was working at the weight loss clinic. So I was primarily working with a weight loss surgeon, where we did a lot of weight loss surgery. And that's when I met my fame to Bollywood happened there. So a lot of people like Reena Roy, probably an actress that you all know from your time, Ganesh Acharya, who's the choreographer. So those were my patients. So that's my claim to Bollywood.
Okay, you also work with Femina Miss India contestants, okay? So
yes.
We have also a lot of lovely ladies who have joined us here, okay? Although they are about 60, but I'm sure they're very lovely. You can also give them a couple of tips.
Absolutely. Age is just a number, so.
All right. Okay, so all of us here this evening, we'll quickly start the session with Kalain. And like we told you, every Saturday at 5:30 in the evening, We have a special program only for senior citizens who are above 60 years and above. So feel free to join us every Saturday. You can also talk to us whenever you want. There's a number that we will share, and you can register yourself or register your friends. And we would love to see you every Saturday, right? So Karine, can you just quickly start the session by unraveling this mystery? What is blood pressure? You know, what is this blood pressure? Is it some pressure like which we get in our taps? What is blood pressure?
Yeah.
I don't know anything about it.
Yes, no, we'll start off with that. I'm just going to share my screen, Vikas, so that it's easy for me to listen. I'm just hoping I'm able to do that. Okay, just let me know if y'all can see my screen, yeah? Yeah?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
Perfect.
Yes, we can.
Okay, perfect. All right. So I think the first question is a question I want to ask all of you. So when you hear the word blood pressure, or when you see the word blood pressure, what is the one word that comes to your mind? When someone says blood pressure. Mrs. Pereira?
Blood pressure problem at all.
So what does it scare you, the word blood pressure?
It scares me. Okay. No, I'm a dialysis patient. I go for dialysis twice a week. But only sometimes when my potassium is slightly high, the pressure goes down. Otherwise, I don't suffer at all.
Okay, great. Anyone else would like to sort of tell me what is the one thing that comes to their mind when I say the word blood pressure?
Too much of salt.
Too much of salt. Excellent. That's great. Anyone else? What's the one thing that comes to your mind when we say blood pressure?
Stroke.
Yes. Okay. Very good. So these are the sort of things that come to our mind, which is not wrong, because all of these words that you mentioned are associated with blood pressure some way or the other. All right. But so let's sort of break it down so that we understand what blood pressure is, because I believe if you know what it is, that's the only way we can sort of manage our lifestyle and our diet. So what exactly is blood pressure? Now, all of us need to have blood pressure, because if we didn't have blood pressure, then the blood from our heart would not be pumping to the other parts of our body, right? So when... So it's basically a normal bodily function. If we didn't have blood pressure, it would have been a problem, because the rest of our parts of our bodies would not be getting the blood, right? So when our heart beats, okay, so the blood from the heart pumps and it flows into all the blood vessels and it goes to all the different organs and the tissues and the cells in our body, okay? So when the heart pumps, that is what is called as systolic blood pressure. And when in between, when the heart is resting, is what we call as diastolic blood pressure. These are words that you all are probably familiar with. So, you know, when you take your blood pressure at the doctor's dispensary or at home, you generally see it in numbers. So it'll always be like a 120 over 80 or a 129 over 82 or whatever. So these numbers are how you measure blood pressure. The top number is typically what is called as a systolic, is when your blood is pumping. And the lower number is typically when your heart is at rest in between pumping. All right. So blood pressure typically by itself is not bad. What is bad is when the blood pressure rises. So high blood pressure is what we should be concerned about, or what is something that we need to manage. All right. So I've just put this down here for us to understand. So some of you who do regularly check your blood pressure at home, or who have been asked to keep a check on your blood pressure, you will be familiar with these numbers, right? So a normal blood pressure reading is between 120-80. Okay, most of us who are older will not have an ideal blood pressure, because as we age, our blood pressure sort of slowly starts creeping up. But a normal blood pressure is between 120 by 80. The higher it is, the higher the risk factors is when we have to start taking precautions, right? So anything which is, say, 130 by 80 or 89 is something that is not a good reading. Anything higher than that is an emergency. So it's good to sort of know these numbers, so that if you are at home and if you are checking your blood pressure, you should be aware of what is high, what is low, and when you need to call your doctor. All right? Okay. Why is blood pressure so dangerous? Or, you know, what? Why do we keep talking about high blood pressure? So, like a lot of you all did mention, we spoke about, someone said stroke when I said blood pressure, which is very true, right? Because what happens with blood pressure is that your heart is pumping and it's going through all these tiny blood vessels to your different organs. Now, your blood vessels are very flexible. You know, they're able to move with the pressure of the blood. But over time, those blood vessels tend to become stiff. They could have fatty deposits. They could start becoming very narrow, which increases the friction on the blood vessels, which is when it becomes dangerous and which is when your blood pressure increases. Now, an increase in blood pressure or constant high blood pressure can actually cause a lot of issues in terms of heart disease or heart failure because your blood vessels start getting really narrow. It can cause heart failure if it's not controlled. Also, the vessels that supply blood to your brain, the vessels that supply blood to your kidney, to your eyes, they're very, very tiny blood vessels. So constant blood pressure, constant high blood pressure can damage those blood vessels, which is why it can cause things like we know as a stroke, can cause paralysis, can cause kidney damage or kidney failure, will cause problems to your eyesight because the blood vessels are very, very tiny. So overall, if you have a constant high blood pressure, it can deteriorate your quality of life, which is why we need to keep it in check. All right. Now, what causes blood pressure? We don't know what is the actual one cause of blood pressure, unfortunately, but we do know that there are some risk factors. There are few things that we can do or are doing or should not be doing that can cause blood pressure. Okay. Now, things or risk factors that we unfortunately cannot do anything about are our age. Okay. The older we are, the risk of getting blood pressure increases. That's something we cannot change. If blood pressure runs in the family, again, your risk factor increases. That, unfortunately, is also something we cannot change. What we can change are things like smoking, chewing of tobacco, if you're overweight or suffering from very, obesity, no physical activity, whether you're not walking, you're, you know, sitting down at home most of the time, too much of salt intake, too much of alcohol intake, stress, all of these things are, again, leading up to causing high blood pressure. So few things we can control, few things, unfortunately, we cannot do anything about. Okay, now, how do we manage blood pressure? Very simple things. It's not rocket science. It's not something you haven't heard from your doctor or your nutritionist or your family members. These are things that we all know. The problem is that sometimes we don't know how to put it into practice. So how do you manage blood pressure? Is that number one, you need to reduce your salt intake. And we'll get into more detail in that. You need to be eating a good balanced diet that has a lot of your vegetables, your whole grain, your pulses, rather than having packaged food or processed food. If you do smoke, it's a good idea to stop. If you do consume a lot of alcohol, best to sort of limit that intake. Try and be as active as possible. I'm definitely not saying that we need to run a marathon or go to the gym. But movement as much as we can is important. And as much as we can to maintain a good healthy weight. I'm not saying we need drastic weight loss or anything at this point in our life, but we need to be at a good healthy weight. Okay. Now, do you all know the reason in terms of why salt is not good for blood pressure? Anybody? Because we keep hearing that, oh, you have high blood pressure, stop having salt. But do we know why? Do we know why we're not supposed to be having salt or why should we use less salt in our food if we have blood pressure? Anybody? I know the answer. I just want to know if you all know. It'll save me the trouble of discussing it. Nobody? Why should we stop or reduce salt if we have blood pressure?
Salt contains sodium.
Very good. Because it contains sodium. Excellent. What happens with sodium? Too difficult a question, now. Okay, fine. So I'll manage that. So like you said, salt is basically made up of sodium and chloride. majority of it is sodium. Now, there's a sodium content of the salt that we need to worry about. Have you all ever left a packet of salt open in your kitchen and forgotten to, you know, cover it tight? What happens to that salt if you forget to close it, or if you don't, it's not in an airtight container and it's the monsoons, what happens to that salt?
It's watery.
Moisture.
It absorbs, moisture. Correct. It absorbs.
Moisture gets.
Exactly, right? So salt primarily absorbs water, okay? So that is what, in simple words, happens in our body. When we have too much of salt, our body tends to sort of hold on to the water, right? Because it's holding on to the water, the volume of our blood increases, right? Because the volume of our blood increases, it's putting a lot more pressure on our blood vessels. So it's constantly trying to, it's hitting the blood vessels, and there's more friction on those blood vessels. So what happens because of that? Our heart is trying to pump even more harder so that the all this extra volume of blood is able to move around the rest of our body, right? So that's putting a lot of strain on that heart, and we have only one heart, right? So the more strain on it, the more pressure on that heart, and the heart is under a lot of stress and pressure because salt will hold on to water. So that is, in very simple words, is why we need to reduce our salt intake or limit the salt intake if we are at a risk of getting blood pressure or are suffering from blood pressure. Does that make sense up until now? It's too much information. Okay, perfect. All right. So now, any of you know how much of salt you're supposed to have in a day? Like, we know we have to have less salt.
1 teaspoon.
Very good. Who said that? I saw it.
1 teaspoon, Lorna.
Very good. So you are supposed to have 1 teaspoon of salt in a day. That is your salt intake. One small teaspoon. Did you all know that? That's not a lot of salt, right? Yeah?
No.
So 1 teaspoon of salt is what we are allowed to have in a day.
In a day.
Right? And we, in our country, as Indians in other countries, we have triple this amount of salt in the day. Okay?
The salt is in everything.
Exactly, because salt is in everything. We're not only talking about the salt that we put in the curry and all of that. Anything that you buy from outside will have salt.
Have salt.
Right? So imagine the amount of salt we're taking. Imagine the amount of pressure on the heart and the strain on the heart for all the work that it is doing for the body. Right? Recommended salt intake is 1 teaspoon. Okay? And sometimes when you have a very high, you know, very serious medical condition, you know, a lot of fluid retention, sometimes the doctor will say have less than that also. So it's not very easy to manage your salt intake, especially when the recommended dose is only 1 teaspoon. Okay, so how do we reduce our salt intake? Is it easy? Do you think it's difficult? Like, how are we going to manage it? Is it only about not using salt, you know, in that salt shaker? Anything that you will do at home? Sorry? Lorna, you were saying something.
It's easy to curtail on the salt.
So how, what do you do to curtail your salt?
Fresh. When we cook, we put less salt.
Very good. Less
salt is put. And then we, with fruits and grains, we check and see. The fruits and the vegetables also. Less.
Exactly.
So then that is a more veg food.
It's easy enough.
Yeah.
So it's not, honestly, like Lorna said, it's not difficult to reduce our salt intake. It might feel a little difficult in the beginning because we're used to eating that kind of salt. But actually, if you go to see, it's not that difficult. Because there are lots of foods that are available that are naturally low in sodium. Like your fruits and vegetables. Fresh food does not have a lot of sodium. So that is why we need to include more fresh food. So your fruits, your vegetables, your grains, your pulses, these naturally have less amount of salt or less amount of sodium. So include more fresh foods in your diet. Okay. Potassium is another sort of electrolyte which will balance out the sodium in the body. So if your sodium intake is too high, then the potassium tends to sort of balance it out. There are lots of fruits and vegetables that are naturally high in potassium. Okay. So if you feel that you're eating too much of sodium, try to also include a lot of foods that have potassium in it. Okay, so your potassium foods are, all of you all probably know, are your coconut water, your banana, your leafy vegetables. These naturally have potassium. Okay, now again, I know there are a few of you all in the audience who probably need to keep a check on sodium and potassium. So this is general advice. This is not going to counteract whatever your doctor is telling you. This is general advice. Okay. So these are the three things you can do to reduce your salt intake. The other thing that probably a lot of us don't do, and I know for a fact a lot of us don't do, is read the back of the packet. Whatever you buy, we look at the front of the packet, oh, the color is so pretty, oh, it looks so nice. We look at the price, we look at everything, but we're not reading the nutritional label. Okay, that is very, very important. Okay, you have to read the nutritional label. It's simple. It's not difficult, to be honest, but you need to get into a habit of doing it. Especially if you're eating a lot of food that comes in a packet, that comes in a bottle, it is important to read nutritional labels. Okay. And the other thing to do, which is also very easy and simple, is try to replace your flavoring. So generally we use salt because we want taste, na? Salt to taste, salt to taste. There are a lot of other things we can do to increase the taste or flavor of our food. Okay. It's just that we're not used to doing it. So a lot of our spices, like Indian food is generally has a lot of different masalas, a lot of different spices. So try and use that as an alternative to adding more salt for flavor. A lot of dried herbs, like we use a lot of mint, we use bay leaves, we use, you know, your coriander, a lot of dry herbs also lend flavor to dishes. Lime, your vinegar, these are things that are all flavoring agents that don't have too much of sodium in it. So instead of adding salt to everything to increase the flavor, we should start adding other flavorings that will reduce our overall salt intake or sodium intake. All right. Yes. Now, we all know, we spoke about what we should be eating to reduce the salt. Do we know what we need to stop to reduce the salt? What are the main things we should stop?
Tin stuff.
Absolutely. Why tin stuff? Anyone knows why we should stop tin or bottle foods for salt?
Because there's lots of preservative. They put a lot of salt.
Absolutely. So I'm sure a lot of y'all have make pickles and chutneys and all at home, right?
Oh, yes.
Mango season, everyone stored all the kacha curry and made mango pickle at home.
Yes, yes.
We have to add salt in that so that it lasts for the rest of the year. So you know how much of salt you're putting in your pickle and chutney. Imagine how much salt they are putting when they are making it in those big manufacturing units, because it has to last for 6 months and 6 years, right? So anything that comes in a bottle, because it has to last for such a long period of time, they have to put preservative so that it doesn't get spoiled. What is your best preservative to keep food from getting spoiled? Salt. Okay, of course you have oil and all of that, but salt is your primary preservative. Yes. Right? Yes. So anything that comes in a bottle, anything that comes in a packet, anything that comes in a tin, I guarantee you that it has too much of salt that it should not be consuming. Okay? So your sauces, your ketchup, your pickle, your papad, those ready masala packets, all of that, your tin food, your corned beef and sausages, all of that have a lot of salt in it because they have to keep for so many months and so many years, right? So avoid anything that comes in a bottle or in a packet. Anything that is ready to eat, anything that you have to take out and put in the microwave or heat up and eat, again, will have a lot of sodium in it because just putting that salt and sodium to keep those foodstuffs from getting spoiled. All your chaknas and your namkeen, chivda packets, your salted nuts, your peanuts, all your chips, anything, all those snack time, evening snacks that we have, all of that will have salt. Okay, so anything that comes in a packet. Cheese, again, is something that we don't know. Cheese is also something that contains a lot of salt. Soup cubes that we put to make the pulao taste really nice and to make all of that, that is full of sodium. Obviously, all of your processed meat. So when you go to the cold storage and you're buying salami and ham and bacon and all of that, full of salt. Okay? Right? So the idea is to avoid these foods that are kept and ready to use, and use more fresh foods to reduce your salt intake. Okay. There are a few things that you can do at home when you're cooking to also reduce your salt intake. Number one, avoid adding salt unnecessarily to things that you can avoid. So when you're making rice, you don't need to add salt. If you're making your atta of your chapatis, you don't need to add salt. Leave that. Your other foodstuffs like your dal and your curries already have enough of flavor. So your roti and rice, you don't need to add extra salt to that, right? Okay. Any other tips that you'll use at home to reduce salt intake while y'all are cooking? Is there something that you do? Any quick tips or handy kitchen hacks that you'll know that you'll use to reduce salt intake?
Sometimes you use a raw potato if there's too much of salt.
Yes, I've heard that, but only if you don't eat the potato at the end of it.
Yeah.
To throw the potato away. If you're going to eat the potato, then all the salt is coming into you. So that's a good thing. So adding like a potato so that it pulls out all of the excess. Anything else that you'll do at home to reduce the amount of salt in your food?
I think you can use lemon
as
food for a little bit of taste.
Absolutely. So flavorings, like we spoke about, how we should use more of your herbs, your lemon, your spices. So reduce the salt and add flavorings and taste in other ways, right? Another very, very, very simple thing to do is that in your salt ka dabba or in your salt packet that you're keeping on your platform, put a small spoon in that. Don't put a teaspoon, don't put a tablespoon, put those, you know, you get those really small spoons, put a small spoon and keep. So automatically, you're going to be using less salt, unconsciously, right? So today onwards, if any of you are suffering from blood pressure, go and change the spoon in your salt ka dabbi. Okay, put a very, very small spoon. So automatically, you will consciously be adding less amount of salt. Okay, anything else that you all do that probably I have not thought of to reduce your salt intake while cooking?
I've also been using Himalayan pink salt. So is that an alternative or that's just basically the same salt?
Unfortunately, it's the same thing. So the amount of sodium content in that only is the same. It has been marketed as a healthier salt, but unfortunately, it's not. Yeah, it looks very pretty and it's...
No problems.
Sorry?
I've just been paying more money for the same problem.
Exactly. You said more money for the same. Absolutely. You said it right.
Okay.
The other thing that you can do to reduce your salt and take it home while you're eating is that try and add your salt at the end of your cooking. Don't add it in the middle of your cooking. So just when you're ready to take off your hundi from the gas, just before it's ready, add the salt then. Don't add it in the beginning because then you automatically get that flavor, right? Also, try and avoid using soup cubes for flavor because they're full of sodium. So typically when we make rice or pulao to add that extra flavor, or if you're making soups at home, we think, oh, we're making homemade soup, it's very healthy, but we'll add one full cube of Maggi cube and then it's no point, right? So these small things we need to keep in mind. Okay, now coming to food labels. Okay, I know that these are a lot of numbers to keep track of, but I'm just putting it here so that we understand what we're looking at when we're reading the food label. Because,
I have one question.
Yeah.
About the salt only. What about the crystal salt, what we get?
Everything is the same. Sodium content is the same.
The crystals, okay. Thank you.
No worries. Okay. So also the other thing to remember is whenever you're picking up a packet of anything from the supermarket or from your grocery store, it does, just because the item itself doesn't taste salty, doesn't mean it doesn't have salt. Okay, like your bread doesn't taste salty, but it will have salt in it because it needs to be preserved. So just remember that not everything that has salt is going to taste salty. A lot of times it's there as an addition or as a preservative. Okay, now when you're picking up any sort of a packet and you're reading the nutritional label, I'll try and see, I think I've put a nutritional label behind. Yeah. So typically when you look at the back of a pack, you will have a lot of these numbers. Okay. So you will always have one column which will tell you per serve how much of nutrients are there. And you'll have one column which will tell you per 100 grams. per 100 grams is sometimes easier to calculate because then you can compare different products. Okay, because the serving size can be different for different products, but per 100 grams it remains constant. Okay, so always look at the per 100 grams column so that you can make a decision as to which product has less sodium compared to the other. Okay, so any food that has less than 400 mg per 100 grams is good, but anything which is less than 120 mg is perfect. That means it is a low sodium product. Okay, so and from a serving point of view also I've put those numbers, but typically 100 grams per 100 grams is easy for you to calculate. Okay, now also remember that when you're looking at the packet, they will not write salt on the packet. You will always not find salt written on it. There are lots of other names that come under salt. Okay, so salt is not always called salt. It will come under different names. So your baking powder is again sodium. Your MSG is sodium. Rock salt, sea salt, crystal salt, pink salt, all of them are salt.
Salt is salt.
Everything is salt. So anything that starts with sodium, so you'll have sodium bicarbonate, sodium nitrate, disodium phosphate, these are all sodium, right? So because when we're talking about salt intake, we're worried about the sodium content of it. So remember, not everything will show up as salt, but it will show up under different names. So anything that comes up as sodium in the name is typically salt, what you need to be aware of. Okay. Mm-hmm. And the short form for sodium is Na. Okay, that's the chemical way how you pronounce how you write sodium. So Na is sodium. NaCl is salt because that's sodium and chloride, right? So these are just terminologies to remember. So when you're reading through your ingredients, yeah. So Na is sodium, and NaCl is sodium chloride, which is your salt typically. Okay.
Yes.
All right. We also we went through this slide when we were talking about nutritional information. So always try and read the per 100 grams column. Okay. Now the other thing on your packet also to remember, because nowadays your food industries and manufacturers have become very smart. Everything will say so much percent sodium less, low in sodium. It's light. It's sodium free. Just remember that does not always mean that the product is low in sodium. Okay. It might be lesser than the original product, but it will still be a high sodium product. So everything that says low sodium or reduced sodium does not mean that it is good for you. So again, read the per 100 grams. Okay. So don't fall for all these marketing tricks and tactics. Be smart, because now you know better. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What about other things that cause BP? What about stress? Does stress cause BP? Does stress increase your blood pressure?
Yes.
So many times you say, I'm so stressed, my BP is going to increase. Does it really happen?
Yes. Yes, of course, because of stress.
So why does this happen? It's because when we are stressed, what happens is that we produce certain hormones in our body, and those hormones basically... You know, when we're upset or stressed, you find that your heart is beating fast, you get all flushed, you get really upset. That is because your hormones are working in your body. And that internally, we can't see what is happening. But typically what happens is that it tends to narrow down our blood vessels. It makes our heart beat even faster. And that sort of causes that rise in blood pressure. Okay. So when you're in a stressful situation, and if you check your blood pressure at that time, 100% is going to be high. Okay. So always check your blood pressure when you're a little bit at rest, preferably in
when you're on this thing.
Yeah. Now, does anyone do any stress management techniques at home? If you're stressed and someone's upset you, you had a fight on the phone or something happens, what do you do to calm yourself down? Any stress management techniques that you can do at home and share with the rest of us? Anybody? Or nobody?
Breathing exercise. Breathing.
Breathing exercises. So very good. What else?
Deep breathing.
Be in your room.
Be in your room.
Well, you can also attend our sessions at 5:30 every Saturday because we also have yoga and we have hobby-based things, so you can come and relax here.
Yeah. So what happens is that when we are stressed, we can't handle it at that point of time. We're in a stressful situation, but we have to make sure that we don't unnecessarily cause ourselves to get upset by certain things, right? So stress is going to happen. I mean, you all know it better than me. That life is full of stress. There are always going to be stressful situations, but it is up to us how we manage it. So breathing, yes, is a really good thing. I remember, you know how we keep saying, if you're angry, count till 10. That is really good, because when you're angry, start breathing, count until 10. By then, all the anger and all that stress is gone away. Sometimes you have to count to 50, but the idea is that you have to concentrate on your breathing. Okay. Yoga, like we said, sometimes it's very underrated. We don't realize how important and how good it is for our health, because when we are practicing yoga, like your pranayama and your deep breathing exercises, you're concentrating on your breath. That again helps to calm ourselves down. Okay. Other things that you can do is that if you like listening to music, put on some music so that you're relaxing yourself. If you like, I don't know, like a lot of people like gardening or tending to their plants or whatever, because that again is very therapeutic. So do something that will automatically calm you down. So whether you like, I don't know, stitching, knitting, gardening, reading a book, listening to music, do something that is automatically going to calm yourself down. Sometimes even picking up the phone and speaking to your friend or a relative is also very therapeutic in itself. All right. So these are few things that you can do at home to manage your stress levels, which indirectly or directly will also help to manage your high blood pressure. Okay. Exercise again is also very important in whatever capacity that you can do, whether it's walking around the house, or right now it's difficult to go out for a walk, but any small movement exercises is very important. I put an asterisk on exercises that because, you know, sometimes we do have instructions from doctors if we have existing heart conditions or joint problems or knee problems. So whatever you're allowed to do, try and set out about 10 to 15 minutes to move so that you're keeping your muscles, and it also helps with mental health as well, right? So some form of physical activity daily is important. Okay. Now, I've put up a few pointers here that could help not only y'all, but anyone who is listening in to help manage stress. Okay. Sometimes stress comes on even when something is not happening. You know, sometimes we feel that there are too many things happening at one point of time. We have to clean the kitchen, and we have to cook the food, and we have to call somebody, and we have to attend. We feel like everything is happening at one time. Okay. So a good thing to manage that is to prepare a schedule, have a timetable, and break down those tasks so that you're not getting overwhelmed that, oh my God, I have to do everything today, right? So break it down, make a timetable, make a schedule so that you can plan your day ahead so it doesn't unnecessarily cause you to get upset and stressed. Okay, we spoke about deep breathing, yoga, pranayama, all of that. If you don't have a hobby, look for something that you used to enjoy doing. Okay, whether it's reading, putting on some music, whatever, watching a movie, sometimes an old movie, or watching a comedy movie, that again will help to relieve that stress. Okay, I would like to ask you all here if any of you all have hobbies, or what is it that you like to do in your spare time?
Lots of hobbies we have.
What do you do, Lorna?
Crochet.
Very good. What about
reading?
Excellent. What about anyone else has hobbies? What do? You like? Cooking. Excellent. That's also in itself very therapeutic. Excellent.
I like to play Sudoku.
Who has someone said something?
No, I said Sudoku.
Oh, yeah. That's excellent, because that is, again, keeping your brain active and you're constantly doing something. So, yes. So, your games, keeping those brain activities, those are excellent. So anything that you enjoy doing, make some time in the day to do that. So whether it's cooking, crochet, reading, cultivate a hobby so that you're constantly keeping yourself in a good frame of mind. Okay. And also something that we don't think about too much is resting and sleeping. Do all of you sleep well at night?
Oh, yes.
Yes, deep sleep? No, good sleep?
No.
Deep, but okay.
How many hours of sleep do you get in the night?
8 to 6 hours.
Okay. Anyone else is sleeping less than 5 hours in the night?
No.
No? Everyone sleeping well?
Yes, yes, yes.
Excellent. So sleep and getting adequate amounts. I'm not talking about sleep, you're sleeping for 2 hours, getting up, running to the toilet or some call is coming or whatever. But good restful sleep in the night is very, very important, because sleep, when you're sleeping, your body is recovering, right? It is when you're giving your body the rest to be able to get ready for the next day. So this is very, very, very underrated. Sometimes you don't realize it, especially now with lockdown and COVID. Sometimes I know we tend to sit in front of the TV, we don't realize you're watching too many episodes of a serial, bedtime is past, and it's by the time you're going to sleep, it's time to get up. So sleep is very, very important also to manage stress, right? So these are a few things I've put down. I'm sure there are a lot of other things that you all are probably already doing to help manage your stress. So if you will want to share it with each other, I'm more than happy for you all to do. But these are things that are tried and tested and definitely work for stress management. All right. Okay. If there's anything else that you all felt that I missed out or you all want to ask me, let's have a little discussion so that you all don't get fed up of listening to my voice only right now. So we can use the last 10 minutes or so just to bounce off some ideas. If you'll have any questions, any food products, salt, anything, so that we can share our thoughts and ideas with each other.
Alan, I had a question to ask you.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll start off. The first thing I wanted to ask you is, what is the difference between potassium chloride and sodium chloride? Are they I know they are different, but how do you manage your salt content in your body using these two salts?
So see, so potassium and sodium basically balance each other out. So that so if you have too much of sodium, then your potassium basically kicks in to sort of get that sodium down. So they work simultaneously to keep each other in balance. So for example, sometimes if you know, your kidneys are basically the main organs that are helping to keep that system in check. So if you do have an issue with your kidneys not working properly, sometimes you will have high potassium levels, which is why then you need to keep your potassium levels down, because too high potassium levels, basically what potassium does is that it rests the heart, it relaxes the heart. So too much of potassium, your heart will relax and then you're done. So that is why you need to keep your potassium levels in check as well. But they have to work in a very good balance to maintain that regularity. So too much of either one of them is harmful for health.
And we get potassium chloride from the diet, from the food that we eat.
Yeah, lots of foods are naturally high in potassium. So the common ones that obviously a lot of us know about is coconut water, bananas, prunes, your raisins, your leafy vegetables. These are all naturally high in potassium. So until and unless you have a condition where you have to manage your potassium levels, these foods are absolutely healthy to have in a regular diet. Obviously, there are conditions like kidney disease, especially kidney disease, where you have to maintain that balance of potassium. But otherwise, these foods are perfectly healthy to have as part of a routine eating pattern.
Okay. Thank you.
No worries.
I'd like to ask a question for my mom.
Yes.
I'm Valerie's daughter.
Yeah.
You mentioned, because you just said kidney, right?
And yeah.
I'm on dialysis.
Yeah.
And she has a lot of this management to do, right? With a lot of food. I remember I heard you earlier saying that, you know, in order to kind of bring down the salt, you need to have fruits. There's a lot of restrictions on fruits too for her because of the potassium content. And you know, so I just wanted to know what are like the allowed fruits in that sense for her, and she had to kind of maintain her potassium, because that's been, you know, a little high of late. So potassium is very anemic in that sense. So leafies anyways get eliminated.
So her potassium levels are high or they are low?
High. come down to normal, but from time to time it reaches like about
So that's the thing. So with dialysis, obviously it's always a time to time thing, because as and when you probably going in for your dialysis treatment, those levels will keep changing. So you will constantly get sort of specific advice to say, okay, today your potassium is high or low. So obviously the information that I gave you is not generic for someone like you, because you are taking dialysis treatment. So I will not be able to give, because that's very clinical advice. I will need to speak to you sort of one-on-one to do that, because I don't want to give out advice that is incorrect, because I've not seen any reports, or I don't have your basic history. So it will be incorrect for me to give specific advice at this point of time, unfortunately.
Thank you, Padma. That's really information. It's been really helpful, because a lot of these pointers, actually we maintain them. We try and keep a low salt profile really at home, because even my sister's got blood pressure. But I think all of
them. No worries at all.
Alain, also, if we need to get in touch with you for any advice or for any consultation, what is the best way to get in touch with you? I'd just like to, you know, put up this question for all the seniors who are watching.
No, absolutely. So I'm available on all of these mediums. Email is a very good way to get in touch with me. So you can put down all of your information. I am very, very active on social media as well. So my Instagram and Facebook, I'm constantly posting a lot of educational videos and things. And I also write a blog about trending topics as well. So if you want to directly get in touch with me for any specific queries, please feel free to send me an email, or you can send me a direct message on Instagram or Facebook as well. So I'm just going to leave it on the screen in case anyone wants to write it down or take a screenshot of it.
Yes, give it.
Okay. So we'll keep it on for another 5 minutes so we can write it down.
Yep.
Also, maybe in a day or two, we will write down a couple of tips that we have learned from this session on blood pressure management, and we will send it to all the members who have attended. So make sure that you have registered yourself with Chinmoy on the number that has been given to you. And we will also send a couple of contact details where you can contact Kalai.
Right. If there's any take home message, if there's any one message that you got from this session, I would like to hear this. What is the one thing that's going to remain with you? Because at least if you take home one message from this full session, then I would have done my job well. So what's the one take home message from each one of y'all?
Reduce salt. That's the first thing.
Very good. Okay. Anyone else?
See what you're eating.
Sorry?
Check what you think.
Yes. Please read the labels. Please read the labels. Look at the back of the pack, not the front and the pretty colors. Yes.
Consciously eat.
Yes. Be aware of what you're eating. Very good. Anyone
else? Try and work on your eating.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Try and cut down on the salt on your intake.
Try
to work on it, yeah.
Yes. And also very, very important to remember is that please understand that your taste buds will take at least 4 weeks to get used to any taste. Okay, so whether you're trying to cut down on your salt or your sugar or your spice, don't expect that today I'm going to put less salt and I'm going to be very happy with it. No, it is going to take time. It is scientifically proven that you need to give yourself at least 4 weeks for you to start getting used to any new taste, because that's the amount of time it takes for your taste buds to get used to it. So slowly, slowly start decreasing your salt intake or your sugar intake, whatever you want to do. But it will not happen overnight. It will take you at least 4 weeks before which you will realize that, oh, I was having too much salt before. So if you go to someone else's house and you're eating food, you will think that food is too salty. But it takes 4 weeks for it to change.
Yes.
I think I'm going to take 1 teaspoon and hang it in my kitchen to remind me every time how much salt is to be used per day, because that was very surprising for me. So now we have a metric, we have a measurement, 1 teaspoon per person.
Yes, and you realize that it's not a lot at all.
I I think I took away, someone asked about Himalayan pink salt, and I really took that away because we really were looking at that as a healthy alternative.
Yeah. No, in fact, if you are on Instagram or Facebook, I've actually posted a video comparing pink salt and regular table salt. There's a video because I used to get asked that question a lot. So I give in brief in terms of why it's not the healthier option. So if you want more detailed information, you can check it out on my Instagram or my Facebook handle. I posted a video specifically talking about pink salt versus white salt.
White salt.
But there are different kinds.
I think rock salt is best.
Rock salt, black salt, in that sense. All of them sodium content is higher.
The sodium content is pretty much the same.
Got it.
Yeah.
There's something known as Cedar Namak. Even that is the same problem.
Yeah. Because when you're talking about salt, right, what you're considering is the sodium content of that salt. So there might be a point difference upar niche in the amount of sodium, but it's pretty much more than 95 to 96% of your salt is made up of sodium.
Okay. Thank you.
So this is very equivalent to, you know, a marketing gimmick that we have been falling for. Thank you for, you know, kind of telling us that salt is just salt. It's not
salt. Salt is salt. That's it. Whichever color it comes in.
Okay. It's expensive, the pink salt.
Great. So any last questions? Would anyone like to ask the last question before we can carry on with the next part of the session?
No questions.
So Kalan, we'd like to thank you for spending, you know, your precious time with us this evening on Saturday.
Okay. Not at all.
We got to learn a lot of things from you, and we got a lot of understanding. You know, my takeaway would basically, you know, if I could just put it down in a couple of words, is that all of these problems that can happen to us, that are right up from heart diseases to, you know, stroke, to even things like kidney failure and failure of the eyes, you know, damage to the eyes, is caused by the high amount of salt in our diet. And the right amount of salt is just one teaspoon. One teaspoon per day. And I think that is a simple solution. And that is the core takeaway that we need to do, is that one teaspoon of salt. And that would, you know, kind of keep us safe from all these issues, you know, which could happen to us in the long run. Right. And also, we need to work on our stress, because the more you are stressed, the kind of emotions that you go through, that will trigger your body to send a couple of chemicals into your body, and that increases your blood pressure again. So less salt and less stress.
Yes.
More fun.
And more sleep, yes. No, as they say, early to bed, early to rise makes a man healthy and wise.
Wise, absolutely. Okay. But it was lovely talking to all of y'all. And thank you so much for having me. And I hope to see you all soon.
Yes, sometime. Yeah, soon. Yes.
Take care, stay safe, and stay healthy.